Okay, we have a solid ball like a baseball and it's rolling down a hill. If it starts from rest, how fast is it moving after it has dropped 0.2 meters in height? So this is the conservation of energy problem. So we'll follow the process for that. We want to draw a y-axis. The ball is here at the bottom and here at the top. So let's call this y0 down here. And this is y equals 0.2 meters up here. That's the initial y, and that's the final y. Okay. We want to show all of the forces on the ball so that we take into account any work that should be accounted for. So here's the force of gravity. Here's the normal force. And here's the friction force, which would always be tangent to the path and perpendicular to n. So here's the friction force. All right, so those are all the forces acting on the ball. We're told that initially the speed is zero, starts from rest, and that means it's not rolling yet either, so also the angular speed initially is zero. And then down here at the end, it's rolling with some final rotational speed, and then the velocity of the center of mass down here at the bottom. And we're asked how fast it's moving at the end. So this is our unknown that we're trying to find, the velocity of the center of mass at the end. Okay, so that was step one, to draw the picture and put the data on there. Step two is to write the conservation of energy equation. Translational kinetic energy, rotational kinetic energy, change in gravitational potential energy, change in the spring, change in internal, and that's equal to any other work done to the object. All right, let's get rid of a few things. We don't have a spring, so we don't have a change in that energy. The internal energy, we don't have to worry about any internal heating or anything like that, so that's zero. Okay, so maybe we have some work on the right side of the equation. Let's go a little further and then decide what happens to that. So for the kinetic energy, translational, so that is 1/2 mv of the center of mass final squared minus 1/2 mv of the center of mass initial squared. Now we have the rotational. So that's 1/2 I about the rotational axis A, which is the center of mass, omega squared, that's final, minus 1/2 I omega initial squared. Then we have gravitational potential energy, mgy final minus mgy initial, and then that's equal to the right side. So we can have work by every force acting on the ball. The gravitational force is already in the equation as the potential energy. We could have work by the frictional force, and we could have work by the normal force. So now we'll take advantage of one of our rules about a freely rolling object, and that is there's no work by the friction. There's also, in this problem, not going to be work by the normal force because the normal force is 90 degrees to the path because theta equals 90. So that force is not doing any work. It's not speeding up or slowing down the ball. Okay, let's see. Let's see if anything here can be zeroed out. The initial speeds can be. So the initial translational velocity and the initial rotational velocities are zero. The final y is zero. Okay, so what are we left with? We have 1/2 mv center of mass final squared plus 1/2 I omega final squared and minus mgy initial equals zero. So those are the only terms that are left. And just logically, the ball starts with potential gravitational potential energy. So that's the only initial energy we have. That's right here. And then at the end, it only has kinetic energy, and it has two types of kinetic energy, translational and rotational. So that's why these are the only terms that are left in the problem. Okay, so some of these things we know, but some we don't know yet. What we're going to do is replace a few things with equations that we have for them. So let's start with I. So I, for a solid sphere or ball, so we look that up in the table, that's 2/5 mr squared. And then omega, we're going to replace omega as well. We know that omega is tied to V. So in general, a tangential velocity is equal to R omega. So in this particular case, we're dealing with the final omega, so this is the final tangential velocity. But we also know that this tangential velocity, because of the rule we just talked about for a freely rolling object, is the same as the velocity of the center of mass. So if that's the final tangential, this will be the final velocity of the center of mass. Okay, so what this means is omega final is equal to, we'll move the r to the other side, v of the center of mass final divided by r. So we're going to put that in there. Of course, all that is squared. So now the equation becomes, this part's still the same. Now we'll stick in what I is, 2/5 mr squared. And that's multiplied by omega squared, but now omega squared is V center of mass final squared divided by r squared. All right, and all that's minus mgy initial. Okay, we can cancel out a few things. So we have an r squared there and an r squared there, so that goes away. We have an m in every term, so let's divide the m's out. We do a little simplification here. This 1/2 multiplied by that 2, it's just 1, so that's gone. So we're left with 1 over 5. All right, so let's do one more line here. So the equation becomes 1/2 V center of mass final squared. We have 1/5 still there. The m's gone, the r squared's gone. There's a velocity of the center of mass final squared. Then minus gy initial equals 0. So out of all the stuff we had originally, these are the only terms that are, or pieces that are surviving. We have a half center, velocity of center of mass squared and a 1/5. So we can add those two together. There's a common denominator of 10, and we have 2 plus 5 is 7, velocity of the center mass final squared. Okay, so we put those two terms together, and then minus gy initial equals 0. Okay, so there's not much left now. We're trying to find the velocity of the center of mass final, so we just algebraically solve for that. So it's going to have 10 gy initial divided by 7 and the square root. And now we can plug in the numbers. 10 divided by 7, g is 9.8, it's a positive, g is always a positive, 9.8 meters per second squared. Y initial was 0.2, and my calculator tells me that that is 1.67 meters per second. So it seems like a lot of work. I think you want to have the procedure down, and then just be careful as you're writing everything down and replacing things. A lot of the variables are going to cancel out, and you're going to combine like we did here, the half and the 1/5. So you just want to be careful about doing those things. But there is a very definitive process to this, and you just want to go through a problem like this a couple of times so that you feel more comfortable with it. And really, it's not a bad process. You just want to be meticulous and not make a mistake with it. Okay, so that's it for angular or rotating kinetic energy.